So welcome back again. After 40 minutes, it gets disconnected usually. So kindly join back. So this is what it happens in variable reluctance transducer. Okay, so the figure shows a simple type of reluctance transducer. Okay, so this is a variable reluctance transducer, right? So this is the surface which has been serrated. So you'll be having a permanent magnet. So the coil will be wounded on the permanent magnet. So you'll be having the north pole and the south pole. So the magnetic flux which is generated by the permanent magnet will be cut due to the flow of the magnetic flux through the circular coils, right? So there will be some resistivity for the flow of the magnetic field, which is called as a reluctance. So these variation in the reluctance will be measured with the help of variable reluctance transducer. So any variation of the permeance of the magnetic circuit which is caused due to the change in flux will be brought about by a serrated surface. So that is, this is the serrated surface. So any variations which has been induced will be calculated with the help of serrated surface, as it can move to and fro over here. So the variation could be sensed. So this is brought about by a serrated surface subjected to the movement. It could be towards the right or towards the left. So as the flux field expands or collapses, a voltage is induced in the coil. So due to the movement of the serrated surface near the permanent magnet, where there is a change in the magnetic flux, it helps in changing or inducing the variation in the voltage. So voltage will be induced in the coil, so which is on the permanent magnet. So you will be having a permanent magnet with north and south pole. So you will be having a coil bounded to it. So the magnetic flux generated by the permanent magnet will be passed through the coil. So the variation in the variation or the resistivity for the flow of magnetic flux will be sensed by the serrated surface which moves to and fro. So this helps in inducing the voltage around the coil which has been bounded on the permanent magnet. So this is how a variable reluctance transducer works. So here you are inducing the voltage with the help of resistivity to the flow of magnetic flux in the coil. With the effect of movement of the serrated surface, it induces the voltage. So variation in the magnetic flux plus the movement of the serrated surface will help in inducing the required voltage in the coil, and that will be recorded or transmitted to any other device, because you'll be having one input connectivity to the electrical circuit and an output unit for the electrical circuit. So here the displacement will be sensed, and based on the displacement there will be an mechanical flux induced in the permanent magnet. So that mechanical flux induced will be resisted by this coil due to the movement, and that resistivity or the reluctance with the help of movement in the serrated surface will induce voltage, and that will be recorded or stored or displayed if you connect to any pointer or any device. If you connect, that will be transmitted. So this is how a variable reluctance transducer works. So next is, we studied the two types of electrical transducers. So one is, what are the three types? The resistive type of transducer elements we studied, the classification of it, and then the inductive type of transducers were done. And last category in electrical transducer is the capacitive type. So what happens in capacitance type of transducer? So how does it work? So a capacitance usually consists of two plates which are separated by a dielectric medium or a dielectric material. So what do you mean by a dielectric material? Dielectric is deadly opposite to that of the conductive material. So we have three mediums. One is dielectric, conductive and semiconducting material. So dielectric material, it resists for the flow of the electric current. It won't transmit any electrical current. It is an insulative material. Okay, but still using an insulative material, if you apply some load, it will be able to transmit the electrical signal even though it is a dielectric material. Example for it is piezoelectric material. All piezoelectric are dielectric, but still when we polarize and deflect the dipoles in it, it will be able to transfer the signal from one end to that of the other. So basically, it consists of two plates, metal plates, which are separated by a dielectric medium. So this dielectric medium can always sustain a static electric field within it. It won't transfer without any external effort, but it can store the electric field, the stationary electric field in it. When you apply some load, yeah, pressure or any deviations, it can transmit these electrical field from one end to that of the other end. So that is the nature of a dielectric medium. So whenever they say capacitance transducer, you should think it has a dielectric medium which has the capacity to sustain some electric field within a net which is separated by two plates. So the principle of this type is that variations in capacitance are used to produce measurements of many physical phenomena such as dynamic pressure, displacement, force and humidity. So capacitance transducers are mainly used in order to measure dynamic pressure, variation of the pressure with respect to time, displacement, okay, force and humidity. So which are mainly used for dynamic type of thing, which varies with respect to time, pressure varying with respect to time, displacement varying with respect to time, force and also humidity varying with respect to time. So these are the main applications or the measurements which a capacitance transducer can measure about. So after knowing what is the main use of capacitance transducer, if you are not very sure, I think in the first year in basic science you have studied related to the basic electrical and electronics concept where you have dealt with what you mean by capacitance also. So if you don't remember, capacitance is nothing but the ability of a body to hold an electrical charge in it. Okay, so capacitance also measures the amount of electrical charge stored for a given electrical potential. You will be having a dielectric material which can store the electric, which can store static electrical signals. So those are nothing but the electrical potentials. So if you embed two plates and provide an input and the negative input and the output signal along with the dielectric material, it helps in measuring the amount of static charge a capacitance has. Because here you'll be having a dielectric medium and you'll be having a plate at the top and the bottom. So when you transmit the given input signal to the dielectric material, so that helps to sense the amount of static electrical signals associated in that material. So that it helps in storing, in measuring the amount of stored electrical charge in a particular material. So that is the main application of capacitance. Okay, to determine or evaluate the measure of amount of electrical charges stored in a given material. So a common form of charge storage device in a two-plate capacitor is, you will be using, if you have the charge on the plates which are positive charge and negative charge, and the voltage gives the voltage between the plates. So if you have charges, so always you'll be having plus positive charge in one plate and negative charge in other plate. So the variation in the charges in between the plus and the minus, in between you will be having a dielectric material which have the stored electrical signals in it. So the variation between the positive and the negative electrical charges will induce the voltage. And this voltage could be delivered into the output signal. And basically the SI unit of the capacitance will be always farad. So 1 farad is equal to 1 coulomb per volt. Usually we get the measurement of the farad, measurement of the capacitance in terms of farad. So the equipment used to measure the capacitance are semiconductor device analyzer. So this semiconductor device analyzer helps to measure the capacitance, the conductance, the resistance for a given dielectric material. So these values vary depend upon what input signal you provide, what is the amount of positive charge you are applying. Every material cannot be applied with the same value of positive and negative charge. It depends upon the capability of the material to withstand or to store the potential electrical charge in it. So again, it depends upon the classification of the dielectric material which you are using. So if you go in depth, it takes much time. So I'm just briefing out exactly how does it work. So in order to get the voltage generated, the variation in the capacitance have to be achieved, right? So between the positive and the negative charge. So how this variation will be generated? It could be done by three methods. One is changing the dielectric material. So dielectric, I told you, it is an insulating material but still have the property for transmitting the electrical force without conduction. It will be storing the electrical power, but when it is embedded between the two plates, due to the variation in the current, it will be helpful to transmit the electrical force from one end to the other, even though it is not a conductive material. So if you change the dielectric material, I told you about the classification of dielectric material. So if you vary the dielectric material, if you vary the area of the dielectric material what you are using, and if you change the distance between the plates, always you won't get the same voltage generated. Here the distance between the plate might be of 1 centimeter. So if you change the distance between the plates to 2 centimeter between a dielectric material, and the area of the dielectric material is also changed, and the type of dielectric material is also being changed, then the amount of voltage which is being generated will be changed obviously. Suppose if you are maintaining the distance between the plate common and you are just varying the area of the dielectric material, then the voltage generated will be different. So if you are maintaining the same distance and changing the material of the dielectric only, so then also the voltage what you generate will be different. So you can vary the parameters and optimize to see that you get a better voltage as per the requirement. Okay. So these are the three categories. So then you should know what you mean by capacitance pickup to measure the liquid level in the given container. So how do you refer this as a capacitance pickup? So the capacitance between the central electrode and the surrounding hollow tube varies with the changing dielectric constant. Okay, so you have a container in which you have a liquid. Okay, then you have a central electrode here, and then you have the input signal connected to the central electrode, and you have an output signal which helps in measuring the capacitance of the given material. So the hollow tubes which are inserted, these tubes which are connected between the two, between the central electrode, are nothing but the hollow tube. So this liquid, again, it is a dielectric medium which is being in the form of a liquid. Okay, so here what happens is the capacitance between the central core and the surrounding hollow tube varies with changing dielectric constant brought about by changing the liquid level. As I told, this was for the solid dielectric material. So changing the electrical plate distance or changing the material or changing the area of cross section of the dielectric material, the voltage induced gets changed. Similarly, when you have a dielectric medium in a container, you have a central electrode which generates the charges with respect to the input signal, and you have two hollow tubes. So in between you have a dielectric medium. So by raising the level of the dielectric liquid or lowering the level of the dielectric liquid, it results in variation in the accumulation of the charges. So due to these variation, the amount of voltage induced also will vary. So this is just a difference for a liquid level capacitance measuring in liquid dielectric material, and this was in solid dielectric material. So variation in dielectric constant can also be utilized for measurements of thickness and density of a given material. So again, it mainly depends upon the application in what we are focusing. Usually this type of capacitance are in use in larger extent where it helps in measuring the dynamic pressure, displacement, force, humidity, etc. So next is capacitive transducer. Okay, so how does it work? So capacitance changes depending upon the change in the effective area. So what effective area you are focusing, based on that the capacitance also changes. This principle is used in the secondary transducing element of a torque meter. We have studied this already in secondary transducer stage, right? Transducer stage 2, which helps in measurement of the torque meter. So this is the main principle used in secondary transducers. Okay, so the same thing has been replicated now for capacitance. So this device uses sleeve with serrations cut axially and a matching internal member with similar serrations as shown in the figure. So you can see this is the air gap. Okay, so this is the internal member and this is the external member. Between these two you have a specific air gap. So you have the serrations here. Okay, so due to the variation in the serration and the air gap associated with it, so it can rotate either in the clock or in the anti-clockwise. So the amount of variation will be helpful in measuring the required value. Okay, so the torque carried by an elastic member causes a shift in the relative positions of the serration, thereby changing the effective area. So when the serrations move, the change in the effective area comes into picture. So due to this variation in the change in the effective area, it will vary the torque. The resulting capacitance change may be calibrated to read the torque directly. The variation in the capacitance, then it could be calibrated to get the value of the torque directly. So it mainly speaks about variation in the torque meter and how do you measure the torque when you have serrations and change in the effective area. So this will be the internal and the external member, which is mainly called as a torque meter, to get the torque reading directly when a variation in the air gap comes into picture with the movement of the internal and external member. So this was with respect to changing area. Then you have capacitive transducer with respect to changing distance. Okay, so the capacitance here varies inversely as the distance between the plates. So you will be having a fixed electrode over here. Okay, so apart from that, you will be having a diaphragm, what we studied already in mechanical transducer. So this is the diaphragm, and this is the clearance value D, which has been given in between the fixed electrode and the diaphragm. So the capacitance varies inversely as the distance between the plates. So you'll be having the two plates associated with in which it will be connected. So you'll be having the capacitance, one with the input and other with the output. So the variation in the capacitance is obtained due to the variation between the fixed electrode and the plates. So the figure shows a capacitive type pressure transducer where the pressure applied to the diaphragm. So when the pressure is applied, so you can see the pressure which is applied in the downward direction. So this is our diaphragm. So when the pressure is applied to the diaphragm, it changes the distance between the diaphragm and the fixed electrode. This is the electrode. So due to the applied pressure, it helps in pushing this diaphragm nearer to the electrode. So then the gap or the clearance between the electrode and the diaphragm varies. So this variation in the distance will result in identifying the amount of pressure change. So you can help, it can help in measuring of the pressure due to variation in between the gap of the electrode and the diaphragm. So this is a variation, this is a measurement of the pressure by using capacitive transducer due to change in the distance. So distance gets automatically changed due to the applied pressure. So due to variation in the distance, what is the change in the pressure? So that could be measured by using capacitive transducer for the category changing distance. So now you should understand what are the advantages of capacitive transducers and disadvantages. So the advantages are, it requires extremely small forces to operate and are very highly sensitive. One is plus point, no external high load or the force is necessary, and it is very sensitive. So for even a small deflection of the load or the force, it can sense and yield the required voltage or the current. Second advantage is they have good frequency response, and hence it can be useful for all type of dynamic measurements. I told you, you can use it for dynamic measurements which vary with respect to time. It could be force, it could be density, yeah, whatever. And high resolution can be obtained. So using capacitive transducers, the high resolution also could be obtained. And the fourth one is they have high input impedance, and hence loading effects are minimum. Due to the good value of impedance, the amount of loading effects in case of capacitive transducers will be the least. And lastly, these transducers can be used for applications where the magnetic fields render the inductive transducers useless. So I told you what you mean by inductive transducers and reluctance transducers. So these transducers could be used where the for the applications which are claimed to be useless in case of inductive transducers. So inductive transducers have the advantage of its own. So where it helps in changing, it helps in measuring the pressure due to variation in the magnetic flux. So which is not capable. So these transducers help in identifying the magnetic fields which cannot render the applications in case of inductive transducers. So these are all the advantages of capacitive transducers. And lastly, you come about disadvantages of capacitive transducers. So first disadvantage is the metallic parts must be properly insulated and the frames must be earthed. Okay, so the metallic parts what you use should be properly insulated. If it is not insulated, then it cannot transmit the signal, the stored charges from one plate to the other in between a dielectric material. So it should not be a conductive or a semiconductive material. If it is so, also it should be insulated properly so that it can store the positive and negative charges, or else it cannot store it. Second, they show non-linear behavior due to edge effects, and guard rings must be used to eliminate these effects. Okay, so usually these capacitive transducers shows non-linear behaviors because it depends, it cannot have a consistent value, so that are associated with edge effects. So in order to overcome these edge effects, it has to be associated with the guard rings so that it can eliminate these edge effects and overcome these non-linear behavior. Third one is they are sensitive to temperature, and as a result, the external environment, the varying in the temperature will affect their performance as well. So this is one of the major drawback. If it is sensitive to temperature, then it will not provide you a good result. So it keeps on changing with respect to variation in the temperature, where the performance will affect drastically. Next is the instrumentation circuitry is used with these transducers are complex. The instrumentary circuitry, the electrical circuits which are been designed with this type of transducers are complex to understand, modify or to redesign the circuit, it will be little difficult. Lastly, the capacitance of these transducers may change with presence of dust particles and moisture. So you should be see that the capacitant transducers are cleaned enough, are kept away from the dust and moisture, or else it results in not yielding with the proper results. So these are the disadvantages of capacitive transducers. So next about piezoelectric transducers, I will deal in tomorrow's class. So now if you have any doubts, you can please ask me, and if you people have not submitted the assignment yet, kindly submit it. And if anyone have not written your name in the USN in your chat room, kindly type it. Hello, everyone have written your name and USN in the chat room.